हेलो भाई, मैं
डार्लिन मैम ऑनलाइन कैसे
देना
ओके नाउ लेट मी कॉल डॉक्टर एस शंकर टू इंट्रोड्यूस दिस चीफ गेस्ट।
थैंक यू मैम।
ओके
वेलकम डॉक्टर अजीत कुमार, प्रिंसिपल साइंटिस्ट ICAR, नेशनल ब्यूरो ऑफ फिश जेनेटिक रिसोर्स। ही कंप्लीटेड हिज मास्टर एंड PhD इन अनामली यूनिवर्सिटी एंड स्टार्टेड हिज कैरियर इन CMFRI ड्यूरिंग 1999। देन ही वर्क्ड एज असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन CAS इन मरीन बायोलॉजी अनामली यूनिवर्सिटी फॉर मोर देन 8 ईयर्स। देन ही जॉइंड एज अ सीनियर साइंटिस्ट इन ICAR इन 2013। Then he promoted as a principal scientist in 2016, currently heading the regional center of NBFGR, Cochin. He guided 13 PhD students and currently he is guiding 3 PhD scholars, and he published more than 143 research manuscripts, 10 books, 25 book chapters and 30 popular articles. He also organized 20 national and international programs, and he is a member of a task force International, sorry, a member, that is the Ministry of Earth and Forest, Board of Studies and Ayyappa University and Chettinad Academy. His area of interest is environmental science, especially ornamental aquaculture. He developed the hatchery technology for most of the marine ornamental fishes. And he received Eureka Forbes Young Scientist Award, K. Chidambaram Memorial Annual Award, Best Marine Aquarium Award from Government of Kerala and Government of Tamil Nadu. We feel proud that you are present here with us today, sir.
Shall I start?
Yes, sir. We welcome Dr. Ajit Kumar, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
You can start, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon, friends. It's my great privilege to be here to talk, give a lecture on recent developments in aquaculture technologies. I think you all are doing well and safe. Before I am initiating my talk, I am extending my sincere thanks to the authorities of St. Jude College, particularly my junior in Annamalai University, Dr. Praveer, and other colleagues for this opportunity. So, I don't know who all are the participants and all, but I am sure that I will not make you much boring, because most of my slides are colorful, because you all are aware that the ornamental fishes are colorful things. So even though I am talking about aquaculture and fisheries, however, my presentation mainly focuses the ornamental aquaculture. So see, you all are aware that India is succeeded with the green revolution and the white revolution. Now this is the time we have to work for the blue revolution. Of course, you all are aware that recently Government of India has launched a program called Blue Revolution, and the name of the scheme is Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. You all had through media and all. Actually, for this particular program, government has allotted 20,050 crore. அதாவது 20,050 கோடி ரூபாய் வந்து த கவர்மெண்ட் ஹேஸ் சாங்ஷன் ஃபார் திஸ் ப்ரோக்ராம், அலாட்டட் ஃபார் திஸ் ப்ரோக்ராம். திஸ் ப்ரோக்ராம் இஸ் ஆக்சுவலி இன்டர்லிங்க் வித் ஸ்டேட் கவர்மெண்ட் ஆஸ் வெல் அஸ் பப்ளிக். ஸோ த சென்ட்ரல் கவர்மெண்ட் கான்ட்ரிபியூஷன் இஸ் அரவுண்ட் 10,000 க்ரோ, தட் இஸ் central government contribution, then state government contribution, then the beneficiary side also, they have also contributed more than 5,000 crore. So throughout the country, it includes both fresh and marine fishes, food fishes, ornamental fishes, and in addition seaweeds. So I am take this opportunity and congratulating the organizer. This is the right time. You took a right topic to conduct this webinar. And also, since this fisheries sector is going to develop, so I am telling what India's stand on fisheries research and what will be the future. Like that, I will be giving a brief introduction about the sector. So the fisheries sector is concerned. We have the ICR, Indian Council of Agriculture Research. ICR, you know that it comes under Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. They have more than 100 institutes throughout the country. However, we have only 8 fisheries research institute comes under ICR. One is on Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute. You all aware that the CMFRI, a well-known institute doing research on marine culture and capture fisheries. It have regional and research centers throughout the country. Secondly, Central Institute of Freshwater Aquaculture, located in Odisha. They are working with the freshwater fishes. Then the third one is Central Institute of Brackish Aquaculture. We are lucky it is located in Tamil Nadu, Chennai. So the next one is Central Inland Fisheries Research Institute. It is in West Bengal. Actually, the Central Institute of Freshwater Aquaculture, mainly their focus is on aquaculture, culture-oriented activities. However, the CIFRI Institute, they are working with these reservoir fisheries and inland fisheries. Then the another one is Central Institute of Fisheries Technology, CIFT. It is rightly located in Kochi. They are mainly concentrating with craft and gears and product like that things they are doing. Then the another one is Directorate of Cold Water Fisheries. They are working with the cold water fisheries, that Himalayan region fishes. Then another one is the Central Institute of Fisheries Education. It is the mainly they are concentrating with teaching the MFSC, Master of Fisheries program, as well as PhD in Fisheries Science. So you all are aware that we have our own fisheries institute in fisheries university in Tamil Nadu. Now it is functioning in the name of Dr. Jayalalitha. Jayalalitha Fisheries University. It headquarters in Nagapattinam, and they have the colleges at Poneri, Tuticorin, and Vedaranyam. Recently, they have initiated a college in Nagarkoil also. So, likewise, this is the Central Institute of Fisheries Education. The 8th institute is National Bureau of Fish Genetic Resources, where I am associated. This institute, actually, if I can elaborately say, the all other fisheries institute, they are working for the today fisheries sector, but NBFGR, the institute which I am associated, is working for the future fisheries. Because why I am telling future fisheries is we are concentrating with the conservation. Main mandate of my own institute is conservation. So that's why we are claiming that we are working for the future fisheries of Indian sector. So in addition to this fisheries institute, I told that fisheries colleges of various state, fisheries university of Tamil Nadu and Kerala University of Fisheries and Ocean Science are especially working for fisheries sector, fisheries and aquaculture sector. So in addition to this fisheries institute, we have other institutes and funding agency, those who are supporting for aquaculture and fisheries researches, DST, Department of Science and Technology, Department of Biotechnology, then Ministry of Earth Science, then EMBIDA. This Ministry of Earth Science, they have sister concern like CMLRE, Center for Marine Living Resources and Ecology. It is rightly located in Kochi. I am happy to share that this CMLRE has launched a program recently called Deep Sea Mission. Deep Sea Mission, this is a very big program there, because we have a lot of resources in ocean, still unexplored resources are there. So now they are planning to resources of deep sea. That's why they are named it as a deep sea mission. So CMLR is the one of the sister concern of Ministry of Earth Science. Then another one is called National Center for Coastal Research. Earlier it is named as ICMA, Integrated Coastal Management. It is rightly located in Chennai and under the campus of NIOT. Now, recently they changed the institute name as National Center for Coastal Research. In addition, EMBIDA, you all are aware, that is the authorized agency for exporting all marine products to the foreign countries. They have regional, or I'm not sure, it is not regional, they have the sister concerns called Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, then National Center for Sustainable Aquaculture. So there is another one big organization in the country working for mainly on fisheries, National Fisheries Development Board. Now this National Fisheries Development is coming under the Ministry of Fisheries. So I think the participants, all you are aware, earlier we are the part of Ministry of Agriculture. So recently we got our own fisheries ministry. So that's why I'm telling this is the right time. Fisheries sector will boom like anything. The blue revolution is already launched. In addition, NIOT, of course, NIOT is working for the engineering aspect, ocean technology. However, they are also developing cages. They are developing desalination plants, like that. Their activities are related to ocean and coastal and aquaculture. Okay, then ZSI, Zoological Survey of India, the National Institute of Oceanography, and Bombay Natural History Society. So these all are the institutes are also working on the partially, yeah, if I can say partially, they can working with the fisheries sector. So see, coming to the fishery sector of India, the entire aquaculture, freshwater aquaculture industry is switching around the three species, the Katla, Rogu, Mrigal. We can say it is a IMC, Katla, Rogu, Mrigal. So the major Indian contribution of freshwater fish is these three species only. Katla, Rogu, Mrigal. We have a well-established hatchery technology for these three species. We are adequately supplying. Even lot of private hatcheries are there. So they are supplying the adequate seeds, and farmers are stocking the fishes and harvesting and marketing. In Tamil Nadu, the coastal states, this freshwater sector is when compared to other sector, other states, it is comparatively the production is less. However, export income point of view, people have started working on breeding and rearing of these fishes and marketing and earning a lot of money. So these all are the three carps also playing major role in the Indian fisheries sector: silver carp, grass carp, and common carp. The earlier this IMC are our own native species. However, these three carp are exotic carps. Actually, it is not native of India. However, we have domesticated these three species. We have domesticated. Actually, different breeding population of these species are available in India. And we have adequately we are producing and supplying the seeds to the farmers, and the farmers are culturing. So even though it is exotic, however, domesticated in India. Okay. So in addition to the major carp, that IMC, Katla, Rogu, Mrigal, recently our concentration is slightly changed over to the medium and the minor carps. For example, Labia calbasso, Labia fumigatus, goleus. And see, because there is a demand for food fishes. There is a very good demand for food fishes. You know that chicken and all, even though we are consuming this broiler chicken, people used to say that so many hormones they are injecting for the growth of the chicken. And so nowadays people stop to consume the broiler chickens. Likewise, mutton. People, those who are having this cholesterol and all, they are avoiding mutton. So the for the protein consumption, fish is the only safest food, and so demand is high and production is also high. So the IMC, only this IMC is not at all facing the demand. So that's why this minor and the medium carps also playing a major role in the sector. And this standardizing the captive production technology has been already developed, and still they are upscaling. They are trying to upscale the production, and they are doing this. Yeah. See, this is the glimpses of the breeding of major carp. Actually, see, this is the photograph which I documented from the institute where I am presently attached. This is the, actually, this major and minor carp is concerned. They have a particular breeding season. So this is the particular season for the breeding of this major and the minor cubs. June, July and August is the breeding season for this. So this is they use to give some hormone for induce the spawning. We are not giving any hormone for inducing its growth. It is for give this hormones only specifically for inducing the spawning behavior. So after injection, they will allow it into the spawning pool. So this female fellow will release the egg and the male will fertilize, and the following days you will get the young ones, and then you can stock into the nursery ponds and follow grow. See, this is the spawn, millions of spawns we have collected through injecting this fishes. See, this is the fingerlings we have produced. This is the minor carp, this Labius calbasu, Raba, Bata seedling. So from the beginning, I told you that our institute, we are mainly focusing with the conservation. So whatever the producing fingerlings, we are not only selling to the farmers or not only providing to the farmers at free of cost. Part of the seeds we are supplying to the farmers, and the rest of the seeds we are stocking to the protected region. For example, in reserve forest region, wherever the water bodies are there the captive produced young ones we are introducing. Here, one thing, important thing we are following is, wherever we have collected the brooder, the same place only we are introducing the hatchery bred young ones also, because otherwise some genetical contamination will come. So that's why, and to stop the inbreeding and all, some other issue will not be raised. If you are introducing the same, where we have collected the same region, we are introducing again. So that is the things. Every year, after the breeding season, we are conducting a mega ranging program in all the tributaries of Ganga in Uttar Pradesh. Yeah. I told part of the seed we are supplying to the farmers also. So here, not only we are selling to them, we are supplying the seed, and we are suggested them to adopt some scientific method. So the scientific data also we used to collect in collaboration with the farmers. So that is the advantage. So we can, whatever the problems and whatever the issues they are facing, that we can witness, and we can find out solution and we can supply. So this is about the, what is called the major and minor carp production. And of course, CIFA, Central Institute of Freshwater Aquaculture, and the CIFRI, Central Institute of Barakpur Institute, this West Bengal Institute, both they are supplying adequate seed to the farmers, and they are also, we are not, what I told in the beginning, we are not only supplying, we are also ranging the seeds. So we are conserving the wild population also. So in addition to this major and minor crops, this is the another one fish called the Clarius batrachus. So locally in our place, we used to call that Kalithimeen solluva nama Tamilla. So this fish also getting now booming. Very good demand in northern India. So now people have started producing this. Here actually natural spawning is very rarely noticed. So here what they are doing is, they are sacrificing the male. They dissected and take the testes of the fishes and squashed and mixing the milk with the egg. So this is the standardized technology people all over the country they are following. In international also they are doing. But recently we developed a technology. In NBFGR we developed a technology to partially harvest the testes. So whatever you have harvested, rest we can dissect. After dissection, we used to stitch the abdomen, and again the fish is surviving. And after a year, the testes is getting grown. So it is proven technology, and we have published the same recently in Aquaculture Journal, partial harvest of testes in Clarius batrachus. Yeah, this is the harvested Clarius batrachus that Magur from a farmer's pond. So we all know about the shrimp. the shrimp, the Apinaes, Monodon and Venami, we are familiar since we belong to the coastal region. We are adequately getting the shrimp for our consumption. But in the northern country, people are preferring the freshwater prawn because there is no other seawater facility and all. So this freshwater giant prawn, macrobrachium species, Rosenbergi is commonly available in all the region and people are culturing this. So the advantages of this prawn is this prawn can even survive the salinity is 10 ppt also, zero to even a freshwater prawn. However, it is surviving the 10 ppt salinity also. There is a very good domestic market in the country. So, well-developed seed technologies available with the Central Institute of Freshwater Aquaculture. They are adequately supplying the seed to the farmers also. So far, what I told is about the freshwater sector of the India. Of course, we have a lot of scope, even though we are facing some hurdles also, but scientists, those who are working on that line, have found some remedies and we are come crossing and we are getting good production. So now this is the time we can talk about the mariculture. Mariculture, you know, that culture of aquatic organisms in salt water. So in India, the Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute, Mariculture, they are the organization developed the technology for mariculture and supplying seed for mariculture. So mariculture technologies now started booming in India also thanks to CMFRI. So the mariculture species, see, whatever technology we are proposing, we need some stocking material. So freshwater is concerned, I told major and minor crops, dozen of species are there. In the case of mariculture, marine, we have cobia. Cobia, then I think in Tamil, modai mean, then sea bass, then silver pampano, I think it is in locally people used to call karami, then milkfish, chanas, mullet, lobster and grouper. So first three, this cobia, sea bass and silver pampano, India, we have a well developed technology for seed production and institutes, they are supplying seeds to the farmers and they are stocking. Rest of the milkfish, mullet, lobster and grouper and snapper, it is the red snapper, that mangrove associated fish. So still the technology development is on the line. This mullet and milkfish, sea bass, Central Institute of Freshwater Aquaculture is working. Grouper, of course, CMFRI is working. Then RGCA, Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, they are working. So this is the fish called cobia and this is pambano. So both we have initiated the culture of these fishes in cages at cobia in 2010 and this pambano in 2011. All credit goes to CMFRI and the former director, Dr. Saida Rao. He only initiated this mariculture in India. So this is the broodstock of cobia, the modai mean solapadiyadhu. This cobia, they are developing broodstock in the CMFRI mandapam hatchery. So this is the breeding. Actually, here they are doing some cannulation. They are checking whether the fish is matured or not. Then after injection, it is giving eggs. This is the newly hatched larvae and this is fingerling and these all are the matured fingerlings ready to stock in the cages. Yeah, this is the harvested cobia. Actually, this in Mandapam CMFRI, they have made a collaboration with the local fisherman association. So they developed a group called the Cobia Fisherman Association or something. So the CMFRI, whatever they have produced, they were given to the farmers and the farmers established cages in the open sea and they rear these fishes for another 5-6 months and they have harvested and they have got good income. So this is the statistics of cage. Actually, cobia fingerling 750 number, they stocked in a 6 diameter cage. The stocking density is 8 numbers per meter cubed. Then they are giving feed of 5% of their body weight. Mainly they are giving Trash fish in the sense these deep sea fishes and our what's called this sardine, the mathimeen, mathichalai, sardine, they are giving us a free as a food at the rate of 5% of its body weight. Within 4 months, the fish retained 1 kg, and within a year, it reached 7 to 8 kg. I think there is a good demand for this cobia fish, and we can sell the meat at the cost of around 300 to 400 rupees per kg. So this is the another promising species, that is silver pampano. The flesh is very tasty fish, karanjit, very tasty fish. So have a very good demand. So CMFRA, again, they have standardized the technology for this, and they are adequately selling the seed, supplying the seed to the farmers. Actually, the earlier cobias fish, it is highly suitable for cage culture only. So whatever you are collecting the fingerlings, you have to stock in open sea and sea in the cages. But however, this silver pampano is highly suitable for pond culture. So you all are aware, you know that before 10 years, there was a huge was going on in Pinnaeus monodon, followed this Pinnaeus tsunami. So wherever that prawn culture, shrimp culture is shut down, now the people have started stocking this pampano in their own ponds. So this can be a very good demand. Even though it is a marine fish, however, it can survive in 10 ppt salinity also. So this is the advantages of this this fish. So those who are having farm in the coastal brackish water region, mangrove region, they can also stock this fish and they can also get the income. So this is again the seed production process of the silver pampano. This is the adult matured fish. Here cannulation is going on. This is the egg, newly hatched larvae, and see, this is the fingerlings ready to stock in the pond system. See, I told that it is highly suitable for the pond culture. So again, CMFRA, they are supplying. Actually, in Tamil Nadu, our farmers are not coming forward to stock these fishes. But in Andhra, there is a very good demand for this seed. So all our seeds are going to Andhra, and in Andhra farmers, they are stocking and they are earning regular income. So again, the next promising species is lobster. Lobster, here one important thing is, earlier whatever I talked about this freshwater fish and the marine fish, we are producing the young ones and we are supplying the seed. But here in the case of lobster, India, we don't have the technology for the seed production. So what we are doing is, we are collecting the seeds from natural water. See, during the fisherman net operation, they are getting lot of juvenile lobster. If a juvenile lobster, if you can bring to the market, it costs around just 10 rupees or 15 rupees. However, after it is getting half kg, it costs around 600 to 1000 rupees. Okay, so what we are doing, we are fattening, we are rearing them, we are making them, little bigger, making them. So that process is called as fattening. Fattening the lobster. Actually, the seed collected from oil, then it will be stocked in the cages, and after 6 to 8 months, again, they are harvesting. Here also, you can give trash fish or some mussels as a feed. So again, this technology developed by CMFRA itself. So this is the harvested lobster in their cages at Kanyakumari. Yeah, this you all are aware that the our Pinnaeus monodon and Pinnaeus venami. Pinnaeus monodon, our own tiger ship, but it faces a issue that white spot disease caused a lot of mortality, and our farmers, they have earned income like anything. However, they faced a lot of loss also. So then gradually we introduced Venami. Venami is not native of India. However, government of India has given approval, and this species is domesticated in India, and most of the culture ponds are running with this Venami. But of course, now Venami is also, I heard that it is also again facing some issues, and our farmers now, they are searching for the new species, no ship. Of course, SIBA, Central Institute of Brackish Water Aquaculture, they are trying to introduce our own species called Indicus, Pinus Indicus. Yeah, this is the prawn form in operation, this Venami and Monodon prawn form. So I told that our own shrimp, this Pinus Monodon, got infected. Now this RGCA, Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, they have a facility at Andaman, and they are trying to bring same Monodon with the SPF, that is specific pathogen free tiger prawn. I think some 6-7 months back, I happened to visit their facility at Andaman, and they told some 13th generation of Monodon they have successfully developed, and shortly they will supply their brooders or young ones to the aquaculture industry. It is since it is SPF, specific pathogen free means, easily it can be reared without any infection, and we can again catch our market on Monodon culture. Yeah. This is another one fish called the grouper. Actually, in local, we used to say kalavai means solagudiyade. So this fish, it is a very tasty fish. So this Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, they are trying to develop the technology. Actually, they got captive spawning. However, the catch out is very less. Only 5-10% success only they got. This is the process of the grouper development. See, the chilled grouper, actually grouper, chilled grouper, there is a very good demand in foreign countries. So this form, Epida, is this RGCA, as I told beginning, they are the sister concern of Epida. So whatever they are producing, they are easy, through Epida they are marketing also. See, this is, I told that Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, they have their own cages in Andaman water. In Andaman Port Player, there is a place called the Chidiya Tapu. There they are, these cages, they have dedicated for the grouper. They stocked their grouper in these cages only. Yeah, this is another one promising fish species. It is called the Seabass, the Central Institute of Brackish Water Aquaculture. They have developed the technology. Actually, all credit goes to the former head of the division of SIBA on finfish aquaculture, Dr. Thirunav Karasu. He and his team, they have developed this technology first time in the country, and they are adequately supplying the seeds to the farmers, and this is the promising field. Still some lacuna is there. Actually, this FCR is not working properly like that. Since some research is going on with the feed formulation and all, this is a promising species, because the taste is also, it is very good. So this is a promising species for the future. So this is the harvest of the Seabass. Again, this is recommended for this cage culture and all. This is the harvested Seabass in RGC. See, again another one promising species, that crab, Scylla serrata. Scylla serrata, actually here in India, this Rajiv Gandhi Center for Aquaculture, they have a station at Karaikal. So they are producing this Scylla serrata seed and supplying to the beneficiaries. So this is the prophecy. This is the egg deposition made by the female crab. This is the crablets. This is the crablets ready to stock in the pond. Farm. Actually, here not like a cage or not like a farm. What they are doing is individual cage. for single crab, individual cage-like structure they have made, because cannibalism is a serious problem in crab rearing. So individual cage they have developed, that structure got succeeded. So initial stage they are putting in one FRP tank or pond or whatever it is, but once it's reached the certain stage, individually they are stocking and feeding them individually. So within some 8-10 months time, they are getting good maturity, marketable size, and they are getting good income through this. So this is the harvested crab. Actually, in the young age, the crab cost is some 100 or 50 or 100 rupees. However, it reached 750 gram, 1 kg means the rate is more than 1,500, 2,000 rupees. So that is the advantages of this crab fattening. So this Perna viridis culture, actually in mussel, the mussel people used to consume, but when compared to Tamil Nadu and other districts, Kerala, this mussel is very famous. We have two mussel culture technology standardized by CMFR, this Perna viridis and Perna indica, this rope culture method, they are adapting. This self-help group in Kerala, they are mainly involving by women group, they are doing this, and they are they used to collect the spat from nearby water bodies, and they are allowing them to attach into this rope and putting simply into the water bodies, brackish water mainly. So after some 4-5 months, it is getting some what is called, they do get maturity, and they are simply harvesting and supplying to the local markets. Almost all the small restaurant, we are getting this mussel. We are getting, since now you know that due to this corona and all, fish catch and all is very much reduced. But every day I am watching on the fish market, this mussel meat is very famous. They used to call that say kaka gari, like that. It is very popular in Kerala. Yes. So, so far I just briefed about the freshwater sector, I hinted about the marine sector. Now we are moving to the ornamental sector, because see, ornamental also, it have a very good demand. Very good demand. Actually, we can say that ornamental aquaculture, it is the sector adding color to the blue revolution, like that, adding the color to the blue revolution. See, ornamental fishes, actually earlier people used to rear here and there, but now there is a very good demand for ornamental fishes, because our day-to-day life is very tough, and we are very busy, getting more tension and all. So science is saying, if you are rearing ornamental fishes, our blood pressure is reducing, and it is a very good exercise for our eyes also. So people have started rearing this ornamental fishes. What you are seeing in this present slide, it is a exotic fish, not native of India. This fish, very good, very costly. You won't believe the cost of this red chili arona is some 5 to 7.5 lakhs per fish. So that much demand is there for ornamental fishes. Ornamental fishes concerned, we have two groups. One is freshwater and another one is marine. Among the marine, there is another one called indigenous and remaining called as exotic. I will brief about both the things. Yeah. So this ornamental fishes, the marine ornamental fishes, we can call it is a living jewels of the ocean, living jewels of the water bodies, because this marine is concerned, whatever you want, if you want a blue color, white color, red color, whatever you want, name a color, we can get a fish from ocean. That is the advantage. Then name a design, you can get a fish. For example, starfish, for example, seahorse, pipe fish. So whatever design, whatever color, it is available in the form of ornamental fishes. So that is the advantage for keeping these ornamental fishes. Earlier, people used to rear only freshwater. Now, science has grown like anything. So wherever sea is not available, there also people are rearing marine ornamental fishes. For example, in Delhi, most of the mall and even airport, they are nicely maintaining the marine aquarium with the synthetic salt and very sophisticated instruments like canister, UV, and protein skimmer, denitrifier, ozonizer. So this is the advantages of ornamental aquaculture. Since the technology is developed, demand is high. People are more fond with rearing the ornamental fishes. So if you are seeing the trade of ornamental fishes, this is the global trade value. But however, India share is very less. Of course, freshwater is concerned, we have Northeast, we have Western Ghats. Marine is concerned, we have Gulf of Mannar, we have Gulf of Kutch, then Andaman and Lakshadweep. However, our contribution to ornamental aquarium industry is very, very less. So this is the time. From the beginning, I told that through this blue revolution, adding color to the blue revolution, we can work on with the marine ornamental, both fresh and marine, and we can generate income. It will help to earn income as well as it is providing livelihood to the coastal and the rural poor of our country. Yeah, so I told that this is the development of aquarium technologies. See, earlier we used to rear the fishes in only in tank. Now see, even dining table, wash basin, all they converted into the aquarium. That is the advantages of this thing. See, this is the mobile aquarium concept. In USA, they have introduced this concept. Actually, their intention is not to promote aquarium technology. Their intention is promoting awareness about biodiversity conservation. To create awareness about biodiversity conservation, daily this vehicle used to travel some 20 kilometers. So people will get some attraction and they will get some awareness. So they are, see, this is the example for technology development. So whatever in the natural aquatic body, they are maintaining in a mobile van. That is the advantages of this aquarium technology recently developed. So this is the another, this is a group of ornamental fishes called this Discus, Oscar, and Angel. Here I want to emphasize one thing. These all fishes are exotic, not our native fishes. However, these fishes we have domesticated, different breeding populations we have developed, and so many people are getting income through this sector. I'm happy to say that in Tamil Nadu, there is a very big market in Chennai, Kolathur. Every day, thousands of lakhs, crores, like that turnover we are getting through this ornamental aquarium trade. See, this is the fish called the goldfish. You all are aware that most of the people used to start the aquariculture with this aquarium, with the goldfish called the Carassius aratus. Why I am putting this slide is actually, see, this Carassius aratus original strain is this one only. But see, how many variants we have. This Oranda gold, Waltail gold, like that, so many things. So these all are not species. These all are variants derived, we obtained from the single strain Carassius aratus. So lot of genetical modification, lot of crossbreeding, so many things are going in and around this sector. Of course, so many things are against to ethics. However, since it is attached with the livelihood, government is also not involving much, because otherwise a lot of agitation will come, since it is attached with the livelihood of the people. See, another one fish called, it is a glass fish. See, the cost of this fish is just 2 rupees, 5 rupees. However, if you are injecting a color powder with this datu ink or something, so it will get a different color. The gobi is interested with red, he will give red color. Yeah, some other gobi is interested with green, he will give to green fish. So this is the advantage. Actually, the trained trader, he can easily inject the fish with this color powder and datu inks. The mortality will be reduced. However, the untrained guy, if he injected, easily mortality is away. But it is a seasonal business. Mainly during the vacation season, school vacation season, this fish, they are injecting and they are marketing it. The school children, during the vacation period, they are buying it at the cost of 20-30 rupees. It can survive in the tank for 1 or 2 months. After that, it will lose its color. It will lose its color, and the fish will also get mortality the meantime the school will open, they are forgetting this thing. So this is the seasonal business they are doing. So this is the freshwater ornamental fish farm in Chennai. So the freshwater farming, we need more area. We need more area, but however, the marine, the limited area is enough because everything is on controlled system in marine. So their limited area is enough for running a thing. So here, the important thing, here what you are seeing, this is the fish called the piranha. Piranha. Actually, government of India have given permission to the aquarist to import a fish called the pako. Paku, P-A-C-C-U, Paku fish. That in the name of Paku, people are introducing piranha. Piranha, it is a highly carnivorous fish and it is spoiling our native biodiversity. Okay, so in the now recently these fishes are found in most of the natural ecosystem. So government is trying to eradicate this system, otherwise we will lose this lose our biodiversity. So in the name of Paku, it is easily coming to our aquarium trade and spoiling our thing. See, another one fish, that sucker mouth cat. You all are aware that this fish, so whoever are maintaining aquarium, they used to keep one of the sucker mouth cat. It is a scavenger fish. It used to clean the waste material available in the tank. So suppose if you are keeping 10 goldfish, you used to keep one this scavenger, sucker mouth also. So this used to clean the tank and consume the waste material and all. So this is a fast growing fish. So a hobbyist, if he is rearing 10 goldfish along with one sucker mouth fish, means fast, within a short time span, this will grow. So what this hobbyist is doing, simply he is collecting the fish from this tank and throwing near the water body. So he is, what he is thinking, he is saving the fish. But recently, River Kaveri, it is reported that the breeding population of this sucker mouth cat is available. So, sorry, it is damaging, it is spoiling the habitat of our native fishes. So, it is a threat, a serious threat to our biodiversity. So, my humble submission to all the participants, if those who are maintaining aquarium near to your home, or if you are maintaining your own home, don't throw this fish into the nearby the water body, because suppose if you are throwing one female, I am throwing one male, accidentally it it form as a pair, and breeding will continuously happen, means it is entirely spoiling our biodiversity. So this is also a serious threat. So here you are seeing is this, these are, I told that beginning ornamental, we have native fishes and exotic fishes. So we have very good resources of native fishes, of marine ornamental fishes. However, our hobbyists, they are exporting, they are importing this exotic ornamentals also. See this color, because of its attraction, they are very fond about these fishes, and they are stocking these fishes in home aquaria. However, this marine fishes, whatever you are thrown in the nearby water body, it is surviving. But these fishes, this marine, it is very difficult to survive. So far, we didn't identify any exotic fishes, exotic marine fishes in our water body. But the freshwater is a serious threat to our water body. Yeah. Then I told that there is a very good demand for ornamental fishes. So the marine ornamental fishes, it is our, we have more than 8,000 kilometer coastline. However, this ornamental fishes, marine ornamental fishes, are found only in the coral reef region only. So coral reef region, during the low tide, all the fishes, easily you can visible, easily you can see the fishes. So what this fish collector, he use do is, he used to apply some cyanide so this fish used to get stunned, and this fellow, he used to collect the target fish. Target fish means which fish get more attractive price. For example, one angel fish is it cost around 2000 rupees, 3000 rupees. So he used to collect only a jet. He won't bother about rest of the fishes like the other group of and the larvae. So it is a serious threat to our biodiversity, applying cyanide. Of course, forest and the government agencies are taking a lot of efforts to stop, but illegal fishing practices are still going on in some water region. So keeping all this mind, CMFRA, Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute, our institute, National Bureau of Fish Genetic Resources, we are taking some effort to propagating these ornamental fishes in captivity, and we are supplying the Yaman to the beneficiaries. In this kind, our institute, NBFGR, recently launched a program called Establishing Marine Ornamental Village in Maharashtra. This program is supported by UNDP through the Mangrusel and Mangrove Foundation of Government of Maharashtra. Actually, through this program, we established a master facility in Thane district. There, we have stocked 10 different clown fishes, and through this facility, we are producing young clown fishes and metamorphosed young ones we are supplying to the beneficiaries of Maharashtra coast. Just we have initiated this program and the beneficiaries are identified. Initially we took three districts, Thane, Palghar and Raigad district. There this Mangrove Foundation is supporting to establish beneficiary unit. So whatever we are producing, we will be supplying. Then we are also providing technical support for the successful growth, and we are making marketing. So here what we are doing is we are promoting their livelihood as well as we are helping conserving our biodiversity. So aquaculture for conservation and the livelihood. So that is the thing NBFGR are doing in Maharashtra coast. So this is the hatchery facility we have established in Maharashtra at Thane. See, these all are the young ones we have produced in our hatchery and ready for the supply to the beneficiaries of coastal Maharashtra. So this is the another one group of fish called the damsel. This photograph which I took during my stay at Annamalai University. There we have standardized this technology for the hatchery production of damsel fishes. See, I told that whatever we have produced, we are supplying to the beneficiaries. So during my stay at Annamalai University, with the support of Gulf of Mannar Marine Biosphere Reserve Trust, we established a unit at Yerwadi, and whatever we have produced in Annamalai University, after metamorphosis, the 1 month reared juveniles we have supplied to these beneficiaries. They were reared for 2 months and they have marketed, and they are getting small income, some 3,000 to 5,000 rupees per person per month, like that. It was well, but when I left from university, we couldn't able to couldn't supply the juveniles continuously, so the program got stuck there. Okay, so conducted the different training program to train the trainees also. So recently we have launched a program in Lakshadweep. It is an ornamental shrimp. So Lakshadweep, you all are aware that there is islands scattered in Arabian Sea. Their livelihood is only depends on coconut and tuna. So we have conducted a awareness program and a training program, and we have trained the beneficiaries. Our main aim is to propagate the ornamental shrimp. Actually, I told that there is good demand for ornamental fishes. Likewise, there is a very good demand for ornamental shrimps. This is not edible. It is hardly possible to consume, only for aquarium trade. So what we have done, we have established a hatchery facility at Agathi Island of Lakshadweep. NBFGR, it is called as the NBFGR and the DBT Gem Blossom Resource Center. Actually, this program is funded by DBT. So we have established a hatchery at Agathi Island on the premises of CMLRE, Center for Marine Living Resources. Actually, this is the old facility. Recently, we launched our own new facility. facility. So we conducted exploratory survey in different islands, Agathi, Kadamath, Kalpeni, like different islands. We have conducted exploratory surveys. We collected this ship. So here I want to emphasize one thing. Here this Eurocardilla, it is new to science. Our institute, we have described this species. Then this species, Thorhaneensis, and this Lismata hochi, this is new to Indian waters. So now, whatever we have described, our institute discovered from Lakshadweep, and what we have reported new to Indian waters, that we are trying to promote in the ornamental aquaculture. This fish, actually, this shrimp available in the market, however, it is coming from wild. Our intention is we have to conserve our germplasm. That's why we have established our own facility at Lakshadweep. We are breeding this and we are trying to supply the babies to the beneficiaries of Lakshadweep. They will rear and they will market it. So this is some old program. Program is just initiated and it is growing nicely at Lakshadweep. Actually, see, I told that we have a lot of resources, we have a lot of opportunities, but still we have some hurdles also. Actually, we have Kalpamannar, Kalpakkach and Andaman Lakshadweep, but all this area comes under reserve forest and biosphere reserve. So Indian Wildlife Act is telling that we are not allowed to collect. So, but even one ministry, they are promoting ornamental aquaculture, but other ministry, they are stopping. So there is no proper notification on ornamental fish trade also. So we have to come across all these things. So we have to come across all the institute, all the research institute and government agencies, universities and NGOs. NGOs, they all form together and they have to make a unit and jointly work on this sector. Means definitely we can boost the sector as a number one in this world, because we have a lot of resources and we have a lot of opportunities. So far I told about, briefed about this fish sector, ornamental fish also. So seaweed, it is a prong sector. In the beginning I told about this Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. They have included seaweed also a major sector in Annamalai University and CSMCRI, Central Salt and Marine Chemical Research Institute in Mandapuram. My senior friend Dr. Ganesan and the team CSR Lab, they are also promoting this seaweed technology. Lot of byproducts they are extracting from seaweed, so it has also a very good scope for this thing. So friends, I am closing my talk on this. So just I have briefed about the fisheries sector, what we are in India. So I started with the freshwater sector, that freshwater culture, Indian major crop, minor crop, then mariculture, this cobia, pambano, where we are standing, what we are doing, then this ornamental fishes, freshwater and marine. Freshwater also, we have a lot of indigenous resources in Northeast and Western Ghats. So we have to develop technology and we have to promote. So marine also, a lot of scope. We are blessed with the Gulf of Mannar, we are blessed with Andaman and Lakshadweep. So we have to conserve our resources. We have to provide livelihood to our friends in rural and coastal areas. So we have to join together and we have to promote the livelihood through, we can succeed. So from the first beginning, I told that India succeeded the green and white revolution. So we all have to work with the fisheries sector and we have to succeed with the blue revolution also. So I'm taking this opportunity to extending my sincere thanks to the organizer, particularly my junior Praveen. Those who have any doubt, you can ask. If the network is not clear or any issues if you are facing, kindly send me mail to this mail ID, or you can make a call anytime I am available, or you can contact me through the organizer. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Very good, colorful session and informative session for us. It is very very interesting. You explained us about the Blue Revolution, Research Institute in India, culture and techniques, and about the mariculture, and lobsters, prawn, and especially SPF brooders, and about the seabass cage culture. It is very interesting to us and very informative. Thank you, sir. And about the ornamental fishes also, it is very colorful and very new information for us. Thank you very much. So now it is time for discussion.
Sir?
Yes.
Participants are asked many questions.
Yeah.
The first question from Dr. Kartika Devi. How to improve fish processing and preservation method?
No, actually processing and preservation mainly working with the CIFT people, Central Institute of Fisheries Technology. I am an aquaculture man. My knowledge on processing and preservation is very limited, madam. Better you can contact this CIFT. If you are very particular, you can mail me. I will give you contact in CIFT. Working with the processing and preservation, CIFT people. Because I told now we are working mainly with the conservation aquaculture. So processing, preservation, even though if I am providing something, it will not be fulfill your expectation. Better you can contact CIFT. Lot of Tamil friends are working as scientists there. They can support you. I will give you link of the CIFT people.
Thank you, sir. Another one question from Gayandra Kumar. Fingerlings are necessary to be stocked.
Not getting brain. Repeat. Fingerlings are?
Fingerlings are necessary to be stocked.
Fingerlings are necessary to be stocked. Yeah. See, otherwise, fingerling, if you are stocking fingerling, you can reduce the mortality. Okay, otherwise the earlier stage means mortality will be high. If fingerlings means mortality will be very much reduced. So always we are suggesting in the freshwater and marine food fish aquaculture, we are recommending the fingerlings to stop.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another one question from Dr. Paniyadma. In the Maldives, 1/3 of fish catch using fish aggregating device that is called FA. Why this device is not used by fishermen in India for commercial fishing?
No, actually, again, the CFT, they have what she told is absolutely correct. But we have also code of conduct and we are also following this. But it is not, regularization is not adopted in the Indian sector. That is the thing. So, we have some initiatives. We have our government also took some initiative, but it is not properly following. We have the same thing, but there is no proper thing. That's all.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another one comes from Dr. Paniyadma also. Until 1990, aquaculture developed faster rate in Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Since then, it has been on downward trend. Would you give reason?
Actually, I don't say now we are downing, because when compared to Andhra, we are behind. But here the main thing is the Tamil Nadu and Kerala both are coastal states. Okay, so compared to culture fisheries, we are depending the capture fisheries. Okay, so we are getting more fishes through capture fisheries. So we are not concentrating, yet to be concentrated more with the culture fisheries. That is the reason. But now prawn culture we are also doing in Tamil Nadu. When compared to Kerala, Tamil Nadu, almost all the coastal district we are concentrating with the shrimp culture. This both Venami and Monodon we are doing. Hello?
Sorry, sir. Another one question from Swaminathan. Please elaborate on marine fisheries village establishment. Is it possible in Madura? Is it possible?
Where? Yeah, Madura.
Madurai. I think so, sir. Madurai.
Yeah. Actually, it is possible only in the coastal area only. Because marine means we need seawater, salt water. Okay, you can rear the fish in marine water. You can rear the fish in synthetic salt water. But if you want to breed the fish, you need natural seawater. You can breed the fish in synthetic salt water also, but the economics is very high. Okay, you have to spend more money and you used to get minimum return. That is the problem. So better for establishing marine village, marine ornamental village, coastal districts are more advisable.
Thank you, sir. Another question from Lake Shahil. What are the benefits of aquarium?
Aquarium means, it is a hobby. Then I told that if you are watching the fish, science is saying that it reduces your blood pressure. Then if you are continuously watching the fish tank, the fish will move here and there. So automatically your eyeballs will move here and there. So it is a very good exercise for your eyes also. Of course, some people, they are believing that vastu, if you are keeping one fish, that arona fish, you will get money. So science is against to that. I am also against to that. But definitely, it is a hobby. It will help to decorate your home. Then it will help to aquarium in the sense decorating this hobby as well as this thing. Reducing blood pressure.
Thank you, sir. The last question. How marine ornamental fishes are more pigmented or colorful than normal freshwater fish?
No, actually, see, the corals are very beautiful. Okay, so I told that all ornamental are associated with the coral reef. So that is the camouflage. Okay, since these marine ornamentals are associated with the coral reefs are naturally beautiful, so the associated organisms are also beautiful. So it is camouflage only.
Thank you, sir. Shankar, sir?
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you for answering all the questions. Thank you. And now let me call Dr. Bhavi Mino for vote of thanks.
Good evening to all. A graceful and warm evening to our most valued guest, useful organizing committee, and the most beloved participant. It is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, Dr. Bhavi Mino, on behalf of the Department of St. Jude's College, Kutu, I take this opportunity to propose vote of thanks. On my behalf, I extend a very heartfelt vote of thanks to our chief guest, Dr. T. Ajit Kumar, sir, who spent time from his busy schedule to grace the occasions and sharing with us your opinion and finding this person back. He explained what are the fisheries in the universities are present in the Tamil Nadu and all over India. And also he detailed explained about the different type of culture, that is freshwater culture, marine culture, and also he explained the aquarium. So really, it's a wonderful presentation and colorful presentation. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank our principal for his moral support, and also I thank our HOD, Darlene Mary. And I mentioned my deepest sense of appreciation and would place on record my hearty thanks to all the organizing committee members for their support. Thank you, all the committee members. In this program, participants are our backbone. So I especially thank all the participants to gather here. Thank you, all the participants. We thank you for being with us this time. It has been a great pleasure. We will meet again tomorrow evening. Thank you very much.
Okay, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.